is the first part in a four-part series on obedience to the law. The question that will inform these four clips is whether or not we must obey the law. The question seems easy enough, and to most people the answer is probably yes. Sure, we may occasionally speed, we may jaywalk, there are times we may rip a CD onto our hard drive or email a song to our friend, we may even purchase the odd film from a street corner. But when push comes to shove, and by this I mean when confronted by the relevant authorities, when confronted by the state, most of us are likely to cower, choosing obedience over defiance. But is this always the case? Rosa Parks refused to give up her seat. Daniel Ellsberg, Bradley Manning, and Edward Snowden challenged the world's superpower, making public a litany of state secrets. The group Women on Waves has set up abortion clinics on ships off the coasts of countries where the procedure is illegal, and lest we forget North Africa, just a short while ago the people of Egypt and Tunisia held massive demonstrations resulting in the toppling of their respective governments. So in some instances, the answer also appears to be no. Now how do we determine when, or even whether, we have an obligation to obey the law? Legal theory offers a variety of responses to this question. One of the more dominant approaches is legal positivism. Held over 2,000 years ago, the trial of Socrates provides one of the earliest illustrations of the legal positivist view. To summarize, Socrates was accused and tried for allegedly corrupting Athenian youth through his teachings. This was a capital crime at the time. Now, Socrates believed in asking questions, in challenging answers, in examining logic, and ultimately in inspiring his students to think for themselves. While these actions appear harmless enough, commendable even to some, to the Athenian establishment they were regarded as disastrous, as young people weren't learning to subordinate themselves to established hierarchies. The Athenian establishment saw education as a conduit for patriotism, for nationalism, and ultimately for subservience. It is where young people learn which gods to worship, the duties they possess, and the lifestyle they should pursue. Socrates disagreed. Instead of an education to promote patriotism, Socrates sought to provide an education in pursuit of autonomy. To some, this explains the impetus behind his prosecution, the threat he posed to the established order. This was certainly Socrates' view, as well as that of many of his students, including Plato. Socrates argued that his accusers could not identify a single student aggrieved by his teachings. He further argued that the charges laid against him were the work of a handful of unsavory individuals who were more interested in protecting the privilege they enjoyed within Athenian society than in saving the state or the youth. Now, what does any of this have to do with obedience to the law or with legal positivism? Despite Socrates' view of the immorality of the charges and of his accusers, he was of the opinion that the law under which he was charged, the procedures employed by the judicial system, the verdict reached by the jurors, and ultimately the sentence meted out were perfectly just. In his view, the legitimate legal authorities had spoken, and it was his duty to obey their command, for their command was law. Think of it this way. Socrates believed he was falsely accused. He also believed that the jurors in his trial acted wrongly. Yet Socrates also believed that his conviction and his sentence had to be respected, for the law of the land, the law of the state, is just irrespective of the immorality of the lawmakers. Stated otherwise, for all intents and purposes, Socrates was a positivist. Positivists assess the validity of a law by asking two questions. Was the law created by a recognized human authority? If so, did the authority follow the appropriate procedures? A law is valid if the answer to both questions is yes. To positivists, both the content of law and its possible relationship to morality are irrelevant. Socrates, for instance, never denied that corrupting the youth was a criminal act or that it was punishable by death. As far as he was concerned, as far as positivists are concerned, a valid law can be moral or immoral to an individual. What matters ultimately is the position of the sovereign, for they determine the validity of a law. In fact, Socrates' willing subservience to the law is communicated repeatedly during the trial. I must obey the law and make my defense. Nor does his position change when facing a death sentence, declaring to the jurors, "The hour of departure has arrived, and we go our ways, I to die and you to live." To Socrates, the unjustness of his accusers did not either corrupt or vitiate the validity of the law itself. Socrates regarded law as one of society's most prized possessions, arguing that it must be adhered to irrespective of personal opinion or personal consequence. The only apparent limit to the sovereign's ability to make law is pedigree, meaning the sovereign must follow the correct procedure when enacting a law. While many are likely to agree with Socrates, as I said at the outset, obedience is largely the norm, some do not, and have articulated two primary criticisms of his position. First, positivism fails to explain how the sovereign decides which laws to pass. Should abortion be permissible or not? Should marijuana be legal and tobacco illegal, perhaps the other way around? Should we tax corporations, or should they enjoy, as many of them do today, a mostly tax-free existence? In the case of Socrates, should the corruption of morality merit him the death penalty? If the sovereign is not guided by moral considerations, how do they decide which laws to pass? Stated otherwise, positivism does not help us distinguish between good laws and bad laws, for it only distinguishes between valid laws and invalid laws. The second criticism of positivism is that it fails to justify the process. Now, as Socrates made clear, the verdict and the sentence were valid, for the relevant authorities had adhered to the relevant procedures. This is straight positivism. A law is valid if the sovereign follows the accepted procedure. Consider the trial of Socrates. In Athens, the accepted procedure for dealing with a criminal charge is trial by jury. Socrates was tried by a jury and ultimately found guilty of corrupting the youth. Now, both the verdict and the sentence possess force of law. According to positivism, the verdict and sentence are valid because they emerge from a legally sanctioned process that's been established by a recognized human authority. But Socrates failed to ask a vital question. Why is the process valid? What if we reject the process through which the verdict and sentence have been rendered? Now, a couple of positivists have proposed two possible solutions. According to Hart, the rule that governs lawmaking is socially accepted. It is not a legal reality, but a political one, meaning it makes sense politically, even if not legally. But what happens if the rule that governs the creation of law is socially rejected? Take, for instance, protests, civil disobedience, or even revolution, as was witnessed in London during the riots and the student fee protests. Hart suggests both the procedures and the laws are invalidated. Now, Kelsen is different. Kelsen identifies a pure theory of law. The rules that authorize the sovereign to make law are what Kelsen calls the Grundnorm. This is the fundamental norm upon which all other norms rest. The Grundnorm can either be accepted or not. If we accept the Grundnorm, the laws that follow are valid. If we do not accept it, the system fails. In other words, positivism depends on our willingness to accept the procedures and the institutions that a society uses to create law. We can think here of parliaments, senates, courts, legislative committees, and so on. If there's acceptance, all is good. If there isn't, well, the theory offers us little way of moving forward. Socrates accepted the procedures and the institutions, and therefore the validity of law. A question you might consider before viewing the second video is whether you do or do not, and why or why not.